I suggest well, when you are making the presentation, you switch on the mic and the video so that we can observe as
Yes.
well.
So if you want, we can start.
All right. All right. So, okay. George Stewart's Nilok and
Yes, sir.
Praveen and ISRO is going to do the presentation. India is not in office today, right? We are
Sorry.
logged in. India is not in office. Can she log in from where she is?
No, sir. She's on the move, unfortunately. So the three of us will be logging in from my PC and presenting, if that's okay.
Right. So you are the leader?
Dave will start because he prepared the introductory and the market analysis. Then we'll be followed by Isuru, who did the interest rate coverage.
Okay.
I will conclude with the equity markets and the conclusion.
Okay. So you said Dev. Dev is a Praveen, is it?
Yes.
Right. Okay. So can you please switch on your video?
Sure. Dave, over to you.
Hi, you are Praveen, right?
Sir. Good evening. So,
Okay.
can I
Okay.
start
Your
now?
topic, please introduce your topic, gearing up financial markets for post-COVID era.
Yeah.
Right. So can you make the introduction of the topic
Yeah, I'll
and
start, sir.
thank
Good
you.
afternoon, I'm Dave.
Good afternoon.
So me and my team will be discussing about the gearing up the financial market for the post-COVID era. And I'll be discussing about the macroeconomic impacts on the Sri Lankan economy for the post-COVID era.
Okay.
All right. The impact of COVID-19 towards the Sri Lankan economy was unlike any other country has faced. And the Sri Lankan economy has been contracted vastly during the year 2020 and 19. This is because most of the active sectors in the Sri Lanka was at a standstill, and most of the service-oriented sectors were operating remotely. And speaking of the inflation was expected to be at around an average of 5% during the year 2019, which was followed by an 4.8% average in 2019, which was driven by high food prices and supply chain disruptions.
Right.
The average inflation declined in the year 2021 for an average of 4.8%. And speaking of the government revenue have been reduced significantly in the year 2019 due to all economic activity standing still. Whereas the taxation was one of the main form of government revenue, and the government was not in a position to collect taxes from the businesses which were not operating at the time. Speaking of government expenditure, the government expenditure was skyrocketing at that period in forms of executing island-wide lockdowns, rationing the general public, and importing vaccines from overseas. This has caused the budget to deficit vastly because the expenditure of the government was overtaking its revenue. And in my opinion, one of the crucial reasons why Sri Lankan economy was hit harder than any other economy was its heavy reliance on its imports. To give it on numbers, in 2018, Sri Lanka imported 4.1 billion worth of goods from China, which accounted for 18.5% in that period, which was only second for India's 19% at that time.
Right.
And the extreme closure of the Chinese economy, followed by the Chinese New Year, to curb the spread of COVID-19, has hit the Sri Lankan market because the Chinese companies was not able to supply to China, Sri Lankan, which delayed their production process. And at that time, it was really terrible, terrible and impossible for Sri Lankan companies to switch their supply chains. And speaking on a global perspective, the IMF has announced a global recession at the period, which was expected to be worse than the financial crisis in 2008. And the Fitch estimated the global economic activity to decline by 1.9%, and the ADB estimated the global drop to range between anywhere 2.3 to 4.8, depending on the demand shocks. And thank you. And rest of my team will be carrying the presentation forward, sir.
Yeah, okay. Now, I need to ask some questions.
Yes, sir.
Can I ask some questions now, or should...
After concluding the presentation, we'll be answering the questions, sir.
Right, good. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
You are Isuru, right?
Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon,
Isuru. I will be discussing about the impacts towards the policy rates for the post-COVID era. The Central Bank of Sri Lanka has taken several measures to reduce interest rates, enhance market liquidity, and finance the government to encourage a low inflation environment. The CBSL provided ample liquidity to the market at reduced and concessional interest rates. In addition to allowing increased currency inflows in the economy and large liquidity injections to the banking system, enabled banks to provide the support required by businesses and individuals to tide over the difficulties faced during the COVID-19 pandemic lockdowns. Key monetary policy instruments such as policy interest rates and statutory reserve ratio have been reduced to the lowest levels in history. Before pandemic, SDF rate and SLF rate was 7% and 8% respectively. And in 2020 May, SDF and SLF rates were 5.50 and 6.50 respectively. The statutory reserve ratio reduced by 300 basis points. And also the CBSL reduced the bank rate, which was 15% to 8.5%. And also the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, in consultation with the government of Sri Lanka, introduced the Saubhagya loan at 4% per annum interest rate to businesses, including the self-employed and individuals affected by the COVID-19 outbreak.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's it, is it?
Yeah.
Right, so then Nilok is going to conclude. Right, okay.
Okay.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Nilok.
Yeah, I will be addressing the about the equity markets, and that will be followed up by the recommended importance of ethical practices and the role played by the market intermediaries. As my colleagues have highlighted before, COVID-19 was one of the, or if at all, the only significant global pandemic that we have faced in our era, where we have seen a vast negative impact across the globe. At the first quarter of 2020, or when the pandemic started spreading across the region, we witnessed a huge volatility in the markets, be it forex market, be it the equity market, and or even the commodities market. Especially in Sri Lanka, which we are addressing right now, we saw the outflow of about 70% outflow of foreign-owned T-bills and T-bonds. The approximate value is around $372 million or so. In addition to that, we saw the rupee depreciate by about 5.3% within the quarter. In addition to that, we also saw this exchange outflow fueled by foreigners exiting our equities market as well. A point to be noted is that prior to the COVID outbreak, the country had already undergone a political instability, which had triggered the foreign investors to pull funds out early on. So, in essence, the COVID pandemic accelerated the outflow and obviously resulted in high pressure on our exchange rate during this period. But something that is noteworthy is, although in the first quarter of 2020, when the pandemic was at its onset, we saw outflows, later on in our equity market, due to the lower interest rates and liquidity injections by the regulators, we saw the local buyers stepping in to purchase the exiting portfolio of foreign funds. So, in my opinion, overall, we did not see as negative an impact that we would have expected in the equity market, thanks to the local retail and probably institutional buying. I will now address the key policy decisions and their outcomes. I had addressed three. So strict limitation of foreign currency outflows was one of the policy decisions that was discussed. Then low interest rates and high liquidity regime. And thirdly, digitization. So during the pandemic, we all witnessed a plethora of regulations being introduced to limit the dollar outflow from the country. This trickled down to mainly two positive impacts for the for companies listed in our stock exchange. One was the local manufacturing and export-based companies saw an improvement in their company valuations due to the restrictions of foreign outflows. We were mostly dependent on local manufacturers as well as export revenue earning companies such as apparel exporters and also to some extent Expo. And as I mentioned before, with foreign investors exiting, we saw the local retail buyers stepping up. This was mainly as a result of the local investors not having sufficient alternatives to invest in assets that would give them a satisfactory return. Secondly, this also trickles down to the low interest, high liquidity regime. The banks' deposit rates were hovering close to about 4 to 6%, and there was plenty of liquidity in the market. However, there was a shortage of loans being distributed. The retail investors obviously then, in my opinion, converted their fixed deposits, which were low interest rate, low return assets, and invested into the equity market, which drove the market to grow. Thirdly, a policy decision that was taken during this period was to digitize the Colombo Stock Exchange, in which the phase one was launched during the period under review. This resulted in onboarding more people onto the stock exchange because you were able to register a CDS account through your mobile phone through an app. So the accessibility to the market was increased through the digitization process. Another policy decision that had a positive impact on the market was the easing of listing regulations. The regulators, after sufficient review, decided to base the listing requirements on turnover rather than cash flow, which allowed new companies that were looking for fresh capital with promising potential to come to the stock market and raise their capital. Finally, there was one additional support that was provided, which was to ease the taxation or incentivize listing companies or listing groups in the stock market. This was, I believe, mainly driven by the respective ministry, the idea of maintaining high growth and in return attracting foreign investors at some point down the line. The probable suggestions that I proposed for improving the market conditions were investor protection, COVID impact disclosures, and listing state-owned entities, and consistent investor-centric policy decision-making. So let me just briefly touch on all four. By investor protection, what I refer to is, in a market such as ours, there are plenty of occasions that we have noticed, particularly manipulative trades taking place, but obviously no action being taken. But this was subject to change with the new Securities and Exchange Commission Act that was introduced in 2021, where the regulator intended and has drafted to address most of the gaps that existed in the previous regulations. It was more on the responsible side for the stakeholders, where severe penalties were prescribed for anyone who was performing illegal trading activities. Secondly, COVID impact disclosures. I think COVID impact disclosure should be provided by the companies that are listed, and this should be requested by the regulator so that the investors are aware how the management has managed the company through the tough times, and which proves as a testament to their management quality. I think this might give a better picture for the investors in terms of a decision making on the soundness of the company. Thirdly, listing state-owned entities. Why I propose listing state-owned entity is because there are a lot of state-owned entities which at the moment require capital and which are very attractive in terms of their market dominance and could be a bright potential for foreign investors to invest in. I would say from my personal experience that plenty of foreign institutional investors would be interested in looking at state-owned entities that are profitable. For example, our utilities, maybe even state-owned banks, a stake. The proposal is not to list the complete float, but at least to list a sizable shareholding, and through that improve the management and accountability and transparency of the organization. The overall benefit from this is for the company, for the country as well. Finally, I propose that we should address more investor-centric policy decisions. By this, what I meant was that policy decisions need to be more consistent, need to be in a more realistic investor protective sense, and in terms of actioning of the regulations, we need to be more strict, give the investors, foreign investors as well as the local investors, confidence that a few select groups of people or investors should not be manipulating the market and they will be dealt with. This is something that I feel is a good characteristic of a well-performing market. And unless we showcase this to the global investors, I do not see a fresh inflow of investors coming in, given the prevailing situations. The biggest deterrent, in my opinion, is the inconsistent decision-making, where overnight decisions impact the equity markets as well as the economy, which kept deterring any potential investor from entering the country. Finally, I'll just quickly touch on the role played by market intermediaries and the importance of ethical working environment. So basically, I think over the last 3 or 4 assignments, we have been addressing this. An efficient market requires a transparent, professional, and an ethical market intermediary setup. The benefits of this is to ensure that price discovery is at its optimum. The information flow is transparent, and the market efficiency keeps improving. In an efficient market where we are sticking to the highest ethical standards, once again this appeals to the global investor base. If we are to become a hub, a financial hub for this region, market intermediaries such as us and other financial institutions need to drastically step up our ethical practices, our market practices, and rather than just list the regulations, we need to show through our actions that we adhere to it. That is very important, once again, as I mentioned, for our growth in the local market. This is overall what we proposed, Mr. Ratnayake. I will conclude my section from here, and we can take any questions if you have.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Nirok. You did a wonderful job in covering a lot of things.
Thank you, sir.
I invite other participants also to raise questions if they have. You are listening. So if you want to ask a question, please ask. I have a few questions to ask. Now, you identified problems such as heavy imports, reduced inflows to the country, and low tax collections, and a few other things. The first two speakers, there was no solutions proposed. But Nirok, I think, covered a little bit of solutions proposed, including listing of state-owned enterprises, and then creating a robust market, customer-centric robust market. So what do you think, are there any other problems? I wonder if you have identified the core problem of Sri Lanka. What is the core problem of Sri Lanka? Now, in order to propose solutions to gear up financial markets for the post-COVID era, there should be some solutions to address the core problems, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Now, to me, the core problems start with productivity. Right, productivity, where the Sri Lankans do not think for new innovations, new products, and then all they are skillful. They are identified. It is an example where Sri Lankans, when they migrate to other countries, when they are in other countries, they are very productive. In fact, they are recognized for their performance and then rewarded and all sort of things. But in Sri Lanka, they are just dormant. Why is that? What are the solutions that you could? Because if you do customer-centric solutions to the stock market or any other things, if the population, workforce, or the population, young adults, if they are not active, if they are not productive enough, can we win the battle?
So if I'm to address that, I think this is more of a holistic response. I feel the problem obviously begins in the system, beginning from the education system.
Yes.
In my opinion, the fact that our education system is based on one principle and our hiring system is based on a second different principle is the
is the cause of the problem to begin with. For example, if I'm to address it in a very smaller scale, let's say we expect the graduates to be of very sound technical in terms of their knowledge, but when we recruit them and we interview them, the question is most on more practical solutions. So if you don't condition the student at the onset to face practical situations and rather address only the technicalities of the subject, then I think we are not prepping them for the job market. So the problem that begins from there then trickles down into people with technical knowledge trying to kind of, you know, migrate into countries where a space. In Sri Lanka, I feel, as per the qualifications, the number of industries and the number of varying job roles are limited. We obviously have the mainstream jobs like a doctor, an engineer, or a lawyer, for example, which is our cultural belief. But if you are good in biology or chemistry, I really doubt. Maybe now there is a bit, but for a biochemist, is there an opportunity to earn sufficient revenue through its job role according to its qualification? I really doubt so. So I feel the system that begins from school has trickled down into the job market, and the frustrations as a result of the mismatching expectations obviously results in the brain drain of our generation. So if I'm qualified enough and I'm unable to find a job role that is rewarding to my qualification, then I would obviously have to look elsewhere, because at some point I have to support the ecosystem around me. So more than a financial or more than a economic solution, I think it's more of a overall structural restructure that we need to think about if we are to address the core problem.
Thank you. I think you touched on the problem. You really touched on the problem. Now, the points to identify here is that we see about 1.8 million work members of the workforce serving other countries in the world. They have been educated in Sri Lanka, and then most of them are performing on very highly accepted reputation is very, very good, because they, when you say Sri Lankan, they embrace you with both arms. That is because their performance, their obedience, their skill, and so on and so forth. And the second point, my second point is that if you publish a matrimonial proposal, and most of the response you get from the overseas, or because the young adults who are in the eligible marriage age, they are overseas. What does this say? Tell us. This is to identify that the you touch on that, Nilok, where the infrastructure and the job orientation and the policy decisions. Now you said about the biochemists not being given a proper opportunity. Now the state should frame the legislation and the infrastructure in such a manner. Whilst in the university last 1 or 2 years, they should be able to contribute to the economy, and then the job market of the leading company should be picking up a highly qualified, highly skillful individual from the universities, and then giving them financial support, and then hiring them at for the third year, fourth year students in the university. And in such a environment to be created, there should be the laws and the legislation and the infrastructure and the setup should be adjusted. I wonder if you remember, when I related an example in my discussions while presenting my presentations to individuals, one from Sri Lanka and one from South Korea, who were employed at a Middle Eastern country in the same factory. And they were, after 11 years of experience, they both decided to go back to their home countries and start up a new enterprises, and then contribute to their own country while developing themselves. When the Sri Lankan came to Sri Lanka and the South Korean went to South Korea, when he did a feasibility report and then presented it to the government authorities and so on, he was given highly recommendations, facilities, and then in fact people to support his proposal, including financing as well. When in Sri Lanka, when the feasibility was presented, he was sent from post to pillar of the government institutions, BOI and the various other institutions. There was no, in fact, it is reported that some government officers demanded bribe as well from him. So after 4 or 5 years, they met again in the Middle Eastern country for a friendship get together. When the South Korean had been a very highly successful businessman, Sri Lankan person couldn't even start up. So that demonstrate that the setup, especially the bureaucracy in Sri Lanka, has to be revamped, right? So that is one of the core problems that we have. Now, I don't suggest that we do have any low grade, inferior quality people here. Despite you are saying that the education system has to be market oriented, those capable guys are looking overseas and they perform very well, contribute very well in foreign countries. Those who are educated in Sri Lanka on the so-called free education. All right? So this is the core problem. If everybody could contribute to the economy and then the economy thrives, naturally our financial markets thrive.
Yeah.
Right. Any other thing that you would comment?
No, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Any others? Any questions, please, from Nilok and the friends?
No, sir.
Why? No, sir, all good.
You should have some questions, because don't be afraid that they will not ask you in
we don't want to put in trouble.
Definitely we'll ask.
Thank you for not asking.
Right, okay.
So please don't ask from us also, okay?
That's a bad habit. I shall deduct some marks for that comment.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Congratulations to Nilok and Isro and Praveen. You have done a good job. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, good. Who is going to take up the next challenge? Please speak up. Mahil, you're going to take up?
Yes, sir.
Right. Mahil, what's your company, Mahil?
Bartley McLean.
Okay, so Mahil is with Gabriel.
Clinton. Yeah.
Right. Only two of you.
Yes, sir.
All right. All right.
Sir, we have made a presentation.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Can you upload?
Yeah.
Do you know how to upload it? Do you get a on the bar below
present now?
Do you get a an arrow up, pointing upward with a box in
it. Yes,
you get, ne?
Yep.
Okay, I'll click on that. When you click on that, a screen will appear. And then we have to click on the big screen.
Your entire screen.
Click on the main picture, big screen, and then you get screen share button on your bottom right. Share screen. Okay. I think you got it. Challenges for money brokers during an epidemic like COVID-19. That's your topic, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. We can see your screen now. Okay. Well, both of you are going to present, is it?
Yes, sir. Yes. Both of us.
Right. Who's going to lead? Mile, you are going to.
Yeah, I'm going to start, sir.
Right. Okay. Go ahead, Mahi, please.
Good evening, everybody. So we are talking about challenges for money brokers during an epidemic like COVID-19.
Yeah.
This is our presentation about this. And in this, we are going to talk about these. We are glancing through these areas in the upcoming slides.
Yes.
COVID-19, which began as a health crisis in early 2019,
okay,
has rapidly evolved to become an economic crisis affecting global, national and regional economies and billions of individuals around the area. The spread of COVID-19 puts additional tension on Sri Lanka, a small open economy with limited fiscal scope to control the pandemic.
Right.
The government has employed wide-ranging measures to curb the spread, and the impact on businesses and to avoid the impact on businesses.
Yeah.
Aided by multinational agencies and support from countries like China, United States, India, and so other countries. Similar to other emerging economies, worries over an economic slowdown in Sri Lanka led to sell-off in the financial market and capital outflows. In less than 2 months, the country witnesses a 70% outflow of foreign owned T-bills and T-bonds. While the Sri Lankan rupee depreciated by 5.3% over the same time period.
Okay.
The central bank activity took steps to erase the burden on the general public during this disruption of global scale, while preventing the focus on its legal mandate to maintain economic, price and financial system stability. These include, but not limited to, the following measures: to reduce interest rates, enhance market liquidity and finance the government, manage foreign exchange flows, maintain exchange rate stability and preserve international reserves, maintain financial system stability and enhance credit flows, ensure uninterrupted currency operations and payments and settlement activities, and manage the public debts. Measures to reduce interest rates, enhance market liquidity and financial government were aimed at supporting economic activity in the context of a low inflation environment. from that. The central bank provided ample liquidity to the market at reduced and concessional interest rates, in addition to increased currency flows in the economy. Large liquidity injections to the banking system enabled banks to provide the support required by businesses and individuals to tide over the difficulties faced during the lockdown period is particular. Central bank also provided required financing to the government to overcome fiscal stresses arising from the shortfall in the government revenue and increased expenditure. This funding enabled the government to provide social security payments for a large share of the population and make payments in relation to the essential health and other services.
Okay.
The COVID-19 pandemic is a permanent threat to the world, which affected the economy of one's country adversely over 2 years of time period. Sri Lanka, being a lower middle income country, had to face the economic downfall drastically. Sri Lanka, with a foreign trade-based economy, has a significant direct and indirect impact due to COVID-19 outbreak.
Okay.
COVID-19 therefore had a major impact on Sri Lanka economy when we compare with other countries, like when those countries were affected, China and UK, USA, European countries. But being a country like Sri Lanka, it affected more than other countries. Sri Lanka foreign passengers are subject to global travel restrictions from mid-March because of this COVID-19. Even the employees who were in those countries, they came back to Sri Lanka, and it affected the money, dollars, because the money which they were sending were reduced and more.
Yeah.
Sri Lanka's agriculture sector has been also affected because of the COVID-19 outbreak, but the sector is only using integrated with global supply chains. From the outset of COVID-19 pandemic, the government adopted timely measures to minimize the impact on agriculture.
Mm.
However, many farmers still suffer because of this loss. They don't have fertilizer and all those stuff.
Right.
The World Trade Organization predict that trade activities will fall by 32% in the country, and poor economic performance is because of weak demand, disruption of the supply chain, travel restrictions, and the lockdown strategy, which are protective steps to further spread of virus. Sri Lankan tourism revenues also fallen down because of this. No foreigners in the country, and we are not getting any foreign currency from those, and that has affected a lot for us. And from here onwards, Clinton will take over.
Okay.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening. Good evening.
Hello.
Yes.
Transportation. Shall I continue?
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. Transportation and communication facilities were not interrupted, and many had the opportunity to work from home. As a result, the money brokers were able to contact the client, bankers, and primary dealers from residence. Main effect of forex market was that because of provision of importation of vehicle market write down the foreign exchange activities, which went through the market of imported if vehicle were not there. Garment industry was able to survive since they were able to switch quickly to personal protective equipment manufacturing, like face masks, medical protective outfits that have a big demand all over the world. In tourism, in turnover, which came to the market was not seen. Individual turnover in respective industries contribute to the downfall expect for the garment industry, which had upturned from second or third month after the pandemic sector in. The impact on money broker definitely is that the reducing volume and increasing the government deficiency through the Central Bank of Sri Lanka to restrict the volumes. Per to the day-to-day transaction in the market and they by the money brokers earning the capacity or the business volume reduced distractly. When the foreign reserve were on the downward hill, the Central Bank came out, imposed the various restrictions such as 100% cash margin, imports of luxury goods. The effect on the FX market, call money bond markets. Sri Lankan is having critical time during the disgracing dollar reserves, which as a result stop outright transaction. At the moment, only swaps are happening. FX market, it's not very active at the moment, since dollar reserve are downfalling distractly. Before the COVID-19 outbreak, the FX volume were always more than 1,500 billion per month, but now it distractly dropped about 800 million. FX volume were decreased, which has a reduced business in the broking industry. Shown below in the graph, the fluctuation of the dollar reserve in Sri Lanka as September 2021. These are the graph.
Okay.
And the monetary policy rates, SRR, before COVID-19 outbreak. Standing okay. Deposit facility rates, 7%.
Okay.
And with the COVID-19 outbreak, borrowing of the call money market increased distractly by leading decreased, which results in defect in the market. Changing the rate, the bond market, which concedes treasury bills, treasury bonds are shown with. These are the charts and T-bill, T-bonds.
Okay.
New ways to face these challenges. There is no quick solution, but rewind the entire the economic activities. Once the current government came to the power, huge tax reduction was done from 15% to 8%, while imposing the various other personal income taxes. Corporate tax was also reduced, and they by government lose revenue up about 700 to 800 billion. That has to be fixed. Sri Lanka has 1.5 million workforce employed in the government sector with least productive work carried out by them. But the government revenues spent on salaries is up to 80% to total revenues. They can be arrangement and they process to automate the government service to the general public, remove the good percentage of the government servant who are supposed to be educated, most of them graduates, to be employing the productive which contribute to better education of children and young adults and better transport service. Better communication service, which all the requirements for all direct investment to come in, thereby invert the cash flows from foreigners invest in Sri Lanka. One of the biggest bottleneck foreigners to come invest in the inferior quality of government service. If all that can be automated and approval process can be delivered in the shortest period of time and with only one few touches point, these approval can be finalized. With a positive note, there can be a lot of foreign direct investments. If these are implemented with 1 or 2 years, maximum 3 years, foreign reserve and foreign market will be raised. And their money brokers challenge will overcome, and finally economy activities will develop so that money brokers volume business quantity will increase. the reduction of VAT from 15% to 8% was actually aimed to increase the volume of business activities in the economy. However, due to the COVID-19 yes. pandemic, sorry, sir?
Yes, I agree with you there.
Scenarios change, yet the government should be encouraged the business community start new business ventures, such as the proposed cement factory in Ambandota, to propel manufacturing, save forex imports, improve the export earning. And the conclusion, COVID-19 crisis induced widespread losses, livelihoods, leading to a significant increase to poverty, to sharp economy showdown, estimate to have increased the $3.2 poverty from 9.2% in 2019 to 11.7% in 2020, leading more than 500,000 additional poor people. As the Sri Lankan economy gradually recovered from the crisis, effort to restore livelihoods to make more than resilient could help the Sri Lankan continue its path of poverty reduction and share prosperity in the medium and long-term policies that expand universalize digital infrastructure could provide the new opportunities for economic mobility. Currently, most of the economy sector have been affected by COVID-19 with adverse consequence on the trade balance and the balance of payment. That government has taken many measures to revive the economy. They have introduced refinancing and working capital facilities for the COVID-19 hit business, injected 240 billion Sri Lankan rupee, the new money into banking system, and suspended imports and non-essential. The lockdown has been lifted, but implication for the economy remain to see the coming months. Thank you, sir.
Okay, very good. Very nice presentation, Gabriel. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So again, may I, Kenneth, please take your presentation out?
Yes.
Good. Questions? Anybody want to volunteer ask any question? There are a lot of material presented. Anyone want to ask a question from these two boys? Now Nilok can, his team can ask questions because they want a fire back question to you, no Nilok? Anyway, in the absence of any questions from the others, I should ask some questions. Your topic is challenges for money brokers during a pandemic like COVID-19.
Yes, sir. Yes.
You made a lot of presentations, especially Mr. Gabriel gave a lot of inputs. What impact a money broker could create? What impact a money broker could create? In other words, you know, money broker's role is arranging funds, whether for an exchange or money market funds, to the clients.
Yes.
And during, especially now, you touched on the working from home concept. Money brokers could join in and then speak to the clients from home.
Yes.
So likewise, what impact? How could money broker change this, address these challenges of pandemic? Any thoughts?
Yeah.
let's you know, basically thinking out of the box, right? Now you are, I know your four corners are limited to dollar rupee call money and then maybe T-bill, T-bond transactions. But there can be, I think we discussed a lot during our classes, that what you could arrange for, you can tap the door of the regulator and then ask permission to do the brokerage services for the corporates, and also create new products. And introduce new products, and then now we don't have any derivative products here in this country, dealt in rupees. So start with a plain vanilla product, which can be helpful. And then I'll tell you, if you start one thing, the next broking house will start another thing. Like that, it will have a contagious effect. Everybody will try to do a new thing. Basically, aim is to survive when there is lean business. How to arrange for more business for you, your broking house, and then broaden the scope for the money brokers, because the money broker's role should not be underestimated. It is an important role, especially where the interest rate curve begins in the call money market. And when you fine-tune the interest rates, and then with the rapid reduction in the borrowing cost to the entrepreneurs, the financial intermediaries and then entrepreneurs, the interest rate curve shifts that toward that end. And then the foreign exchange rates are also like that. It starts with the interbank market. And then when you provide an improved rate to one of your clients, those clients are going to give better rates to the end users. And then thereby entire economy benefits. The standard of living of the general public, the consumer prices index is going to improve dramatically. Because now the whole thing is a matter of playing their own bit of role with unprecedented knowledge and skill, so that value addition is created to everybody. Money brokers are right in the center between the buyer and the seller and the lender and the borrower. So therefore, your contribution will reflect from the shortest end of the curve to the longest end of the curve, right? So the impact that money brokers could create is going to be enormous if new things can be implemented, suggested. Just because when you say the regulator doesn't permit us to do our own account trading, and then we should be putting our hands together and then seated here, it's not the game here.
Yes.
It's not the game here. You must negotiate. You must present your case with think tanks and then speakers, forums, and then collating the ideas, and then get your seniors to speak to the regulators and get them get their permission to at least crack the ball in at one end, and then creep through, and then make your headway to the major zones of businesses.
Yes.
So as you all explained, the challenges faced by money brokers are enormous during a pandemic. Your business volumes comes down, and then health problems on the other side, and then contactability on the other side. But there should be solutions proposed and achieved and then worked out. Okay. All right. So thank you very much for the well-written proposal, well-written write-up, and a good presentation by both of you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Especially by Mr. Gabriel, it's a good presentation.
Thank you.
So congratulations there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. So are there any questions from others? No? I'm surprised. Okay. So then we'll go to the next presentation.
So we are going to do it.
Yes. For which company are you?
SMB Money Brokers.
Right. Okay.
So how to share the slides?
You get at the bottom of the screen, do you get a arrow up pointing upward within in a box?
Yeah.
Click on that, please.
Okay.
Then you get a screen and click on the main screen. Just click on the main picture.
Okay.
And then on your bottom right, you get a share screen. Did you see that?
Yeah. Right?
Yes, click on that. Then open your presentation. If you are stuck, you'll have to go, redo it from the beginning.
Okay, sir.
I suggest you first you open up your presentation and minimize it on the computer, and then click on that box arrow upward.
Presentation.
Did you open your presentation and minimize it? Menaka, another line again.
Who is that?
Menaka, Bulanda, me guide karanda, ekula presentation ka upload karan.
Oh sir, Bulanga, arrow kiye ka miss kara ma. Yaad option tunak kena me entire screen kela a option ne ka click karan kya na?
Oh.
Ita passe main screen ne ka uda click kalla share button ne ka press karan hari. Arrow key එක උඩ click කරාම option 3ක් එනවා. එකෙන් entire screen.
Okay.
Your entire screen. Hello. Hello.
Avanti, respond to Menaka please.
Hari.
Miss ඒකේ දැන් arrow key එක උඩ click කරාම option 3ක් එනවා.
ඒක
entire screen click කරන්න.
Hari.
දැන් main screen එක main මේ 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 screen එක උඩ click කරලා share button එක highlight වෙයි blue color එක ඒක උඩ click කරන්න.
Okay. Hari.
Yeah, one name.
My screen presentation, you know.
स्क्रीन ఏ షేర్ ఉన్నా హలో
ఓ
మిస్ అరం ఎరో కీ ఏ కూడ క్లిక్ కరామే ఆప్షన్ తున పహదిలిద మిస్టర్
ఓ ఎతనింగ్ అపే మంగ ఇతనే ల్యాప్‌టాప్ ఏక స్లో ఏ ఇంద మేక షేర్ వెన్నే హై కమక్ నే మే సర్ షల్ వి డు ఇట్ వితౌట్ ది స్లైడ్స్
Yeah, your choice. That's okay.
They can switch on the camera, sir.
Yeah, please switch on the camera. Please switch on the camera. Good.
So, good evening, everyone. My team.
Good evening to you.
My team and I will be presenting to you on how the Sri Lankan foreign exchange market impacts the economy. So over to you, Asanchika.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, everyone. First, I will explain about the history of currency in Sri Lanka, then about the foreign exchange market, Real and Parliament Act and compliance policy, history of currency in Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka has a long and rich history, as well as long and rich.
Asanchika, your topic is how Sri Lanka forex market impacts the economy, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. Okay.
When researching a country history, coins from various time period play a key role. A coin, despite in small size, has the power to provide a plethora of information about the economic and cultural. History of the currency where it was used. Sri Lanka has been divided to several periods. The use of the currency in Sri Lanka has been divided to several periods, such as Anuradhapura era, Polonnaruwata era, colonial era, and post-independence period. Large number of the international coins from Anuradhapura era, they have funds a large number of international coins. It is because of the foreign trading, and it was affected to the economic of Sri Lanka as well. When I moved to talk about the from foreign exchange market 1950 to 1977, post independent period since establishment of the Central Bank of Ceylon, the Monetary Law Act number 58 of 1949 gave birth to the Central Bank of Ceylon. On August 28, 1950, British banknotes were used in Ceylon until 1951, and British gold notes were used to until 1963. In 1963, the first of Sri Lankan coin series was released. The Ceylon emblem was first used on the observes of this coin series: 1 cent, 2 cents, 5 cents. 10 cents, 25 cents, 50 cents, 1 rupee. According to the above mentioned era, inside the Sri Lankan successfully implemented the usage that was necessary in trade and economic activities, and it was to the pinnacle of foreign affairs in international dealing, serving foreign vessels with the close touch of the friendliness and entrust. However, it is critically of understand that all countries' economic and trading operation were at the center of attention in the past, and that this island was once of the one richest in republic in the Indian Ocean. Because of international trading, exchange rate was important of Sri Lanka, as it is the open economy. The forex market is one of the world's largest, most liquid, not accessible in market shaped by the major global events such as Bretton Woods and the gold standard. The majority of European main countries were in ruin because of the World War II. In fact, after the stock market crisis of the 1929 World War II, transforming the US dollar from a failed currency to the benchmark currency against which most other international currencies were measured in order to make a stable environment better according attempted to the create foreign exchange market, which was a currency exchange rate policy in which one currency in fixed against another. Then 1971 allowed the USD dollar to free floating against other currencies. During World War II, there was not enough gold to back to number of USD dollar in circulation. The button would according failed to the page gold to the US dollar. President Richard M. Nixon dissolved the Bretton-Woods Agreement in 1971, allowing the US dollar to free floating against other currencies. The Smithsonian Agreement, since in December 1971, was comparable to the Bretton-Woods Agreement, but it allowed for the wider currency in fluctuation soon. 1972, the free floating system was officially adopted. As a result of adapting to the win of the dollar in 1972, the free floating system was officially adopted. According to the Parliament of the Democratic Socialist Republic of Sri Lanka, the central bank has the government agent in responsible for the carrying out the provision in order to guarantee proper promotion and regulation of foreign exchange in Sri Lanka. Next, I will be about the relevant Parliament Act. Central Bank is Republic for carry out the provision in order to guarantee proper promotion and regulation of foreign exchange in Sri Lanka. And the Central Bank authorized duties and functions are discharges. And every licensed commercial bank shall be permitted by the Central Bank to function as an authorized dealer to deal in foreign exchange, subject to the theme of Section 9, as soon as such banking awarded in license to carry out banking operation under the Banking Act number 13 of 1988. Finally, I will talk about compliance policy in foreign exchange market. They are transaction exposure, translation exposure, corporate earning exposure, and operating exposure. Economic exposure, transaction exposure, all payable and receivable denominated in foreign currency are generally regarded to have an income statement impact, dividends, service fee, royalties, tax and duties, and other items may fall under the category. Translation exposure, the exposure to the balance sheet that occurs from the consolidation of foreign firm finance statement into the home currency. Corporate earning exposure, impact of the currency fluctuation on the company's intent after tax consolidated earning in measured. Operating exposure, the impact of the currency rate variation on the entity panel cash inflow and outflows in reflected. Economic exposure, this comprises all document or projected transactions, assets and liabilities that will affect the company's cash flow when exchange rate fluctuate. This is the frequent links into long-term 1 to 5 year approach to the exposure control. Over to your Tisaru.
Thank you, Lasandika. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Sadarwan, is it?
Yes, sir.
Ah, good. How are you? Good, good. Go ahead.
Fine, sir. First, I will talking about the foreign exchange market from 1977 to 2020. Sri Lanka began a massive economic like liberalization program in November 1977. The regime changed free trade and payments largely from restrictive policies. The central bank abandoned the fixed exchange rate regime in favor of more market-based system of currency rate management in order to confirm the new liberal regime. The exciting two currency rates were harmonized on November 15, 1977. At an initial rate of 16 rupees per dollar. The basic exchange rate was devalued by 120% overnight after that. Under regulated exchange rate regime, the rupees was permitted to float. As a result, the exchange rate at the end of 1977 was rupees 15.56 per US dollar, compared to rupees 8.83 per US dollars at the end of 1976. Between 1978 and 1983, annual fiscal deficits averaged 13.3% of GDP, with external current account deficits average 10.8% between February 1978 and January 1985. The National Debt Plan of 1982 was formulated against the purpose queue of exciting monetary and credit policies. It tied the target monetary targets in the plan were defined in order to maintain the consistency between financial and real output flows the economy. Sri Lanka's official international reserves had declined significantly by the year 2000. The exchange rate was put under great pressure by the growing demand for foreign currency. This naturally resulted in greater pressure to international reserve within the managed floating currency rate regime. In order to defend the managed float, the central bank raise its policy interest rates to unprecedented level. Next time we'll be talking about recent penalties imposed by regulators. Financial penalties are imposed institutions for non-compliance with the terms of financial transactions reporting ACT number 6 of 2006 under the authorized given under section 19 read along with section 19 of the FTRA. As a result, the FIU as Sri Lanka's regulator for anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist financial imposed penalties of 3 million of financial institution between April 1st and the 3rd June 2021. And next time we'll be talking about market best practices. Prior to offering credit facilities to a client, the stockbroker's firm is required by the established rules to examine the client credit worthiness. After determining the credit quality of each client and considering the value at risk margin of each security, steps should be taken to stabilize the buying power of each client. Client who have not opted for the online trading platform will be provided with the waiver option to see statements of accounts, portfolio holdings, and other information. Send fortnightly electronic alerts to client informing them of overdue balances and keep record such interactions. Stockbroker firms have also been told to take the necessary steps, monitor sector and security expose on a daily basis, as well as to conduct stress testing at least once a week. Stockbroker firms will be required to ensure that tolerance ratio and limitations are set in accordance with corporate objectives, structurally and overall risk appetite, with the note outlining topics to explain. Stockbroker firms are required to have documents, contingency plans in place, with approved and reviewed on a regular basis, which addresses unforeseen early warning indication contingencies and scenarios, triggers events, contingencies, funding schemes, and contingency process should be considered while creating a contingency plan. Over to you, Karim. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thanks, Sadhru.
Thank you, Tisaru. So I will be speaking on the foreign exchange market, the current foreign exchange market. So the main reasons for the currency depreciation were the reduction in the worker remittances, where there was a tremendous fall in the inward worker remittances, which was a reduction from $813 million in December 2020 to $453 million in June, and a further depreciation in August 2021. So this has led to balance of payment account deficits, which finance around 35% of the country's import expenditure. This also has, in the first quarter of the country's, this also contributed around 35% of the import expenditure. So this also led to a depreciation in the Sri Lankan currency, as this contributed to quarter of the country's current account balance. Under the current transfers, as they accounted for nearly 10% of the GDP, which amounts to $7 billion average annual inflow of worker remittances. So next, the reduction in export income. Since the trade deficit widened in March 2021 to -832 when compared to March 2020, as the exports were valued at $2,982 million and imports were valued at $5,041 million. So next, the fall down of the tourism industry. Due to travel restrictions, there was a downfall in the tourism industry, where the tourism industry contributed to 5% of the total economic revenue. And the main one of the main reasons for the depreciation in the currency was the substantial overseas debt payments. So this is proved by the availability of official foreign reserves in Sri Lanka. So there was a reduction in foreign exchange reserves of $2.8 billion after settlement of $1 billion in the month of August, which shows a scarcity of dollars, which led to a further depreciation in the currency. Henceforth, authorities limited the amount of foreign currency that can leave the country and discourage purchasing imports like dairy products, cosmetics, clothes, and electronics, which led to import bill soaring and stocking inflation weakening the rupee further. Moreover, due to extended lockdowns, it also led people to buy excessively, and also was identified that they will have to increase interest rates again in order to control the inflation rate. Moving on to mindfulness, there are several organizational structures involved in order to administer the floating or managed exchange rate in Sri Lanka, and they are responsible for the fluctuations of the currency. So first, the central bank. The central bank takes a number of measures to influence the exchange rate, where they will decrease interest rates, expand money supply with regard to the given expected inflationary pressure. This tends to devalue the value of the currency, which is better for them to increase interest rates and reduce the money supply in order to see an increase in the value of the currency. Also, due to the appreciation in the US dollar from 185 rupees to 200 rupees, licensed banks were asked to stop trading foreign exchange forward for 3 months. So this was a bad decision for the money broking industry too, as they were not able to do forward deals, which led to a reduction in their income, further leading to a mitigation in the GDP. So next, the Treasury Department. They influence the currency by printing money, which leads to an expansion in the money supply, leading to a devaluation in the currency. Instead, in order to see an increase in the value of the currency, they will have to stop printing money, which leads to a reduction in the money supply. And at last, the government. They also can influence the exchange rate by issuing treasury bills, where they also can borrow money from other foreign countries, which increases debt and increase money supply, which devalues the currency. They also can use expansionary fiscal policies. Moving on to facilitating customer benevolence. Customer benevolence is where any institution, organization, or any individual acts in a way that benefits their customers. It can be proven that when there was an appreciation in the currency, the country's economy was doing well, where the citizens were also able to maintain their standards of living. So when talking about the affordability of the basic necessities, in the first quarter of 2021, there was an appreciation in the value of the currency. So which also led to 8% increase in the real GDP, and where people were having higher standards of living and they were able to afford their basic necessities. And next, availability of food, availability of basic necessities. It was identified that due to the currency depreciation, citizens were suffering from food shortages, as regulations were imposed on importing sugar, rice, milk powder, and other necessities due to the inability of commercial banks to finance imports, which further led to a tremendous increase in prices. And at last, poverty. Since some traders were hoarding stocks of milk powder, flour, cement, and gas, the general public were in trouble, where poor people were unable to afford their necessities, which in turn led to an increase in poverty from 9.2% in 2019 to 11.7% in 2021 due to increase in prices. So, as explained above, Sri Lanka has dealt with different currency fluctuations. And since they have overcome these negative currency fluctuations through expanded industrial-based industries, agricultural and other industries, I believe that they will have to implement more policies like smart exchange rate policies, where they can use export push packages, which will help them to improve export income, export diversification, public and private investment, and foreign direct investment, which will lead to a more dependable forex income, which will lead to an appreciation in the currency. Furthermore, as mentioned by the Harvard research, in order to stabilize the currency, Sri Lanka has to be able to make their exports more competitive and globally visible, such as Ceylon tea, Dilma, and Sri Lankan tourism. Next, Sri Lankan citizens have to adapt to locally manufactured goods. So, as this will reduce imports leading to forex savings. And thirdly, they will have to develop university education systems in Sri Lanka. This is done in order to avoid young adults seeking foreign education and to improve the balance of payments by improving the forex revenue by enrolling foreign students to degree programs of developed local universities. Next, they will have to encourage local entrepreneurs, where government can encourage entrepreneurs such as proposed Dangwa Ceylon Steel Corporation cement factory in Hambantota to produce 3 metric tons of cement in order to improve Sri Lankan infrastructure to avoid forex expenses on imports and possible forex income when excess is exported. Next, they can introduce a proactive debt procurement system where they can introduce more financial instruments for the government securities market, which could be managed by experts with treasury knowledge in order to meet market requirements, which will lead to an improvement in the debt securities market, increasing volumes and making progress towards Colombo as a regional financial hub developing financial markets. They also can develop technical capacity on public debt management frameworks, where they will be able to monitor debt, build up and adopt better fiscal management policies, where borrowed funds will be allocated wisely for development projects, with much needed financial assistance, which will eventually lead to accountability and transparency. They also can get assistance from the International Monetary Fund in order to overcome the current situation. This is important as they help countries to secure financial stability, facilitate international trade, sustain economic growth, and reduce poverty. And at last, I believe that government will have to act as an independent authority, which is free from political pressure and corruptions, which will stabilize the rupee, further leading to national account stability, growth of exports, GDP, investment, and international competition. However, even though these policies lead to an appreciation in the value of the currency and improvement in the economic growth, increasing debt make economies vulnerable, leading to sudden stops in capital inflows, outflows, and bringing a bad reputation. Thank you.
Thank you, Kamini. good joint effort. I think majority effort would have been put forward by Kamini, is it?
So we divided it equally.
Right. Okay, okay. Now, on one question on the spur of the moment, I think I raised this question in communicating with you prior to your submission of the written report. You are mentioning that government should be free of political influence. Government, naturally, government is conducted by a political party, isn't it?
Yeah, sir, as in the political corruption.
Oh, you said political corruption.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So, questions from others?
No, sir.
Now, I think Sandarwan was indicating that currency depreciation was due to reduced tourism and then reduced worker remittances. Am I right?
No, sir. I mentioned it.
Ah, right. Okay. How did you mention?
Yeah.
Now, yes, true, but the big picture is not that, isn't it, Kavindi?
Mm-hmm.
During this period, yes, we saw about $4 billion reduced by the income from the tourism, and also the worker remittances was scaling down to some extent. But the major problem lies with the productivity of our country, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you take the decades of the economic performance, I think you yourself mentioned, I think Rasangika or Sandurwan mentioned that the rupee was 16 rupees in 1 year, 16 rupees for a dollar in some year, isn't it? Now we are talking about $203 per dollar. So why did the rupee depreciate eternally? Not only during the pandemic period, in the recent past, rupee depreciated right throughout. The core problem is the less productivity, right? When there's no productivity, no produce goods and services to export. And then as one of you mentioned, when Sri Lankans are eager to grab the imported foreign produce, and that create demand for imports, and then import bills have to be paid. So this perennial problem has to be addressed. And now one or two solutions are that the IT industry, the emerging IT industry in Sri Lanka, the IT professionals by developing the needed software and then other programs, they export and then to other countries and then earn some billions and few billions of dollars, and that number is increasing. And it has become, I think, the largest revenue earner for Sri Lanka at the moment. Fourth largest revenue earner for Sri Lanka. We have to identify such revenue earning capabilities and promote them. And then enhance their capabilities as well. So then, and then as quite rightly, when Kavindi pointed out that we have to get the Sri Lankan population to embrace the local produce than going for foreign products to reduce imports. So those are the ways to reduce the currency depreciation. Then one other policy decision that you could have brought up, Kavindi, is that when in foreign trade, we always use a US dollar or euro or something as a currency of trade.
Yes.
Now, our biggest trading partner is India. And the next is China. Two economic giants in our neighborhood. Why are we invoicing or paying invoices in US dollars to these countries? We could use Indian rupee to pay India and Chinese yuan to pay China. Because that leverage between the US dollar makes our economy perform very badly. That's one suggestion you could have made. To use bilateral currencies. Now, alternately, they could have used Sri Lankan rupee as well. So that will create more demand for rupee, reduce the depreciation. Imagine a time that we pay for imports in Sri Lankan rupee. We can negotiate with the exporter in India to pay them in Indian rupees. They will accept it, isn't it? Because they are currency Indian rupees.
Yes.
Why should we use US dollar to pay India? This is, there's a policy decision. I think government to government, Indian government and Sri Lankan government has to get in touch with each other and negotiate to open up the two currencies to the respective countries. It is true that the Sri Lankan rupee outside Sri Lanka is illegal and the Indian rupee outside Sri Lanka or out in India is illegal. So those policy adjustments could be made easily.
Yes.
So we could, for trade between India and Sri Lanka, although there is some ACU, Asian Clearing Union arrangement between India and Sri Lanka at the moment, which is benefiting Sri Lanka to some extent. I think lack of 2 months time for payment for imports or something, that's the benefit to Sri Lanka. But still, it could benefit India and Sri Lanka both if we use either Indian rupee or Sri Lankan rupee for the trade between our two countries. And similarly, we could use Chinese yuan or Sri Lankan rupee in trading with China. So then what we do is we gradually make our Sri Lankan rupee currency also international currency. So likewise, there can be small suggestions that you could brought up.
Yes, sir.
Then finally, I want to ask a question like this. Could Sri Lanka forex market make an impact on the economy? Can the forex market make an impact on the economy? What do you think? You can or you cannot?
It can, no?
Yes, as it is, I think that it is a very small market. So therefore, but however, fundamentally, the forex market, exchange of foreign currency between buyer and the seller, towards funding the import and export, at least when it is functioning smoothly, the high margins kept by the seller or the buyer can be reduced. Thereby, the importer or the exporter, the end consumer, will get a better rate. That is the function that are being played by the forex market in Sri Lanka right throughout. But increase of products and increase of advisors, use of derivative markets to cover the risks and so on and so forth, can make Sri Lankan forex market very vibrant. And particularly money broker's job can be very much lucrative. High income generating job it can be so much. If you think out of the box and introduce new products and promote with your clients, banks, and who you're dealing with, the buyers and the sellers. So you could have brought up that argument as well. Increasing new products and then services, advisory services, and creating new avenues for money broking business. Thereby, you can make some changes to the volumes of forex market in Sri Lanka, and that will, as we have learned right throughout, the forex market, the wholesale market happening, will definitely guide the exchange rates to the forward dates, the positive moves. So therefore, when the volumes increase, the activity increase, and the economy, as you said quite rightly, GDP increases. So therefore, you could add those few points to your research as well. So are there any other questions by anyone? Mahil and Trevo?
No, sir.
No, sir.
My God. Okay. So then thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations to all the three of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So now the time is 5:46. There are two other presentations, is it?
Yes, sir.
One by Trevor's group and other one by Pickett Chapman, Trini. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
So, any others who did not present? Can I make a suggestion?
Yes, sir.
We have a day tomorrow as well. So we'll Tilini from Pickett Chapman and then Trevo from will agree to present it tomorrow. Yes. Can you do it?
Sir, can we do it today?
You want to do it today?
Yes, sir.
You may have to stay at least a few minutes more. No.
That's okay, sir. We are at office.
Okay. Okay, then. You can start then.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Yeah. we are from Vishwin Money Brokers, and our topic is Sri Lankan forex market and the foreign debt crisis currently in Sri Lanka. First of all, I'd like to introduce, give a small introduction about forex, what is forex market is.
Can you please introduce your team first?
Yes. Myself, I'm Trevor, and there is Sachitra, Lakshan, and Kavishka.
Okay.
Yeah. Forex market, as we call as FX market, is the trading of a
currency. Lakshan is Bandara, right? Lakshan.
Lakshan Aluvihare and Sachitra Bandara.
Sachitra Bandara. Okay. Okay. Right. Go ahead, please.
Yeah. Foreign exchange market, or as we call as FX market, is a trading of the foreign of the currency for another. For example, as we do in Sri Lanka, US dollar against LKR. So as we know, as money brokers, FX market is the main income for money brokers. As I, if I'm not mistaken, 75% of our income comes from the FX market. And forex market is the largest, most liquid market in the world, with billions and trillions dollars changing hands every day. There is no centralized location. Rather, forex market is electronic network of banks, brokers, and institutions, and individual traders as well.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, as we know, Sri Lankan is a domestic foreign exchange market. We can fold into two, that is the clients or retail market, that is individual, individual involved transactions. And as we know, interbank and the wholesale market, as we do as money brokers. The main organized among authorized dealers in foreign exchange, which compromise all licensed commercial banks. The market helps to manage foreign exchange liquidity within the banking system throughout the currency conversion. The main function of the foreign exchange market is convert currency in one country into another currency of another, and help minimize the risk arising from changes in the exchange rate through various derivative products. Above features of the foreign exchange market facilitate funding imports, converting export proceeds, and other foreign exchange transactions. Actually, we know that there is few main risk in the foreign exchange market. That is the mainly volatility in the exchange rate. As we all know, now currently we don't trade in the market cash term spot. We are not trading. We only trade only swaps. That's also only two-legged swaps, not many legs. So those days we were actually doing 5 legs, 6 legs, and rather like we were doing 7 legs swaps as well, connecting banks. So currently we only do 2-legged swaps. And if the volatility is excessive, it would create instability in the foreign exchange market, and thereby would affect the foreign currency assets and the liability of the individual institutions or the bank. There are derivative instruments available in the foreign exchange market, such as swaps, options, and forwards. As we all know, there are three bases in the market: cash, term, spot. And after spot next, we can after 1 week, we can that after 1 week, they are called forwards. So that's a brief introduction of the FX market. And let me hand it over to my colleague to go through the forward presentations. Thank you, sir.
Trevor, your topic is Sri Lanka Forex market and current foreign debt crisis, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay.
Hi, sir. I'm Kavishka.
Okay.
Kavishka. Yes, so I am here to explain about the development of the forex market of Sri Lanka throughout the years. So simply we know the definition of foreign exchange market. It is the market where one currency is traded in another currency. And from those days onwards, the Sri Lanka foreign exchange market has been developing with the effects of other global events such as globalization, and with the technological instruments coming to the foreign exchange market, FX market expanded widely, and transaction volumes were also increased. One major instrument of this category is the Bloomberg trading platform, as we all know. It helps all the dealers to find out the news about the financial markets as well as the market rates in the foreign exchange market. Nextly, talking about the Sri Lanka versus the foreign the global foreign exchange market. The foreign exchange market, which is also known as the forex market, is a market which has developed hugely in the last decade, and it has grown worldwide. But in the present time, it is the biggest financial market in the whole world. Most developed countries have the most powerful currency, and therefore they have got the privilege to have a big foreign exchange market. For example, such as United States of America, United Kingdom, and China has a powerful forex market. When comparing it with Sri Lankan forex market, the Sri Lankan is still in the lower stage of foreign exchange market. In a developed foreign exchange market, there are so many forex instruments which is used to do foreign currency exchange transactions. Some of those foreign exchange instruments are outright transactions, currency swaps, interest rate swaps, forward agreements, and futures. But however, in Sri Lankan market, there are not that much of forex instruments to do transactions. And the only available instrument in Sri Lankan forex market are the outright transactions and currency swaps. So this will also show that the Sri Lankan market is still in the beginning stage of the forex market when comparing with the other large forex markets. But there are some reasons for Sri Lankan foreign exchange market to not go beyond the par with other currencies, other countries' foreign exchange markets. So one reason can be identified as the intervention of Central Bank of Sri Lanka. And this slide will be explained by my colleague later. Lakshan will explain about that in the later slide. And the next slide is the foreign debt crisis. It will be done by my colleague Sachitra Bandarasa.
Good evening, Sachitra.
So basically, foreign debt means the borrowed amount of the government, and government tends to borrow money if they cannot afford the projects they have. So some main reasons for borrowing can be identified as the finance to finance the budget deficit, to procure war materials, to provide employment opportunities for emergencies such as flood, drought, and outbreak of disease. To borrow from the local markets, government use treasury bills and treasury bonds. And to borrow from overseas markets, government used SLDBs and ISBs. However, there are consequences that government has to pay when borrowing from overseas as well as from local markets. This all borrowed amount has to be repaid, and if it wasn't a donation, there will be interest rate charged also. Main consequences of having national debt are can be identified as the lower the spending on new government projects. It means when foreign borrowings increase, the interest cost for those borrowing will also increase. Therefore, government has to spend more money to pay interest rates and less money for other projects. Greater risk for a fiscal crisis. When governments borrow more and more, the investors will start to fear about the economy, and rather than investing, they will pull out the money from the particular economy. Low interest rates, slower growth. Because of the payment that I have to be paid for the borrowers, government would like to keep the interest rates lower, and by that way they can pay their loans with a low cost. But this will slow the growth of the country's economy, decrease the ability to respond problems. Because of the high due amount in foreign borrowings, government will not be able to spend money for the urgent incidents such as natural disasters. However, for the last couple of years, Sri Lankan debt has been increased hugely. If we compare it with 2012, the government debt position as a percentage of GDP was 64%. In 2019, it has grown up to 67%. To talk about intervention of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka, I would like to invite Lakshan Udayan.
Hi Lakshan, how are you?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
So I'm going to talk about the Central Bank intervention to increase export to about USD 1 billion per month, because there are close to 1 billion interest I have to pay every 4 months time, January to April and April to August and August to December, it close to 1 billion. And because this payment have to pay, because we already granted 38 billion foreign loans from different institutions and countries, 38 billion, because this is the, why? Because we have to increase the export to about USD 1 billion per month. And the second one is in encouraging import alternatively, and payment of addition interest on special deposit accounts, and paying extra 10 rupees for every dollar pay addition interest on special deposit accounts, and negotiating short-term currency swaps with international counterparts, and reduce ISB imposed towards 10% of GDP by 2024, facilitate the improvement of current country's sovereign credit ratings. And that is, I'm going to explain about how intervention about central bank in Sri Lanka for minimize the debt pressure in this country already facing. And these are the points I'm prepared with you all. Thank you.
Is that all?
That is all, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now I read through your report. In that report, in the conclusion part, when I read, I get a feeling that you all see some good in central bank intervention in the market. Is central bank intervention in the market is good? What do you all think?
It depends.
Well, if you open up your conclusion, you start with this forced central bank of Sri Lanka to stop free float of the foreign exchange market, and they have put restrictions on the transaction that are done. When you read that paragraph,
yes, sir,
you get an idea that you'll see a good side of central bank intervention. Normally, in the market, we see without central bank intervention, and it's a demand and supply driven market we are looking at, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So, if you can, I think no one touched on that in your presentation, but when I read through your report, I found that particular paragraph. You are indicating that the central bank intervention is good for the forex market. Is it so, or am I wrong in my understanding?
Yeah, at some instance, it can be okay, sir. That's why I told it depends.
Mm-hmm.
Situation by situation, it depends.
But overall, when there are controls and by the regulator only, the end users get a bad deal, isn't it?
Yes, here we have mentioned that
for example, these days, when the dollar rupee is fixed at 203, when the unorganized market, unauthorized market goes at 240.
Yes, sir.
So that is one reason for Sri Lankans not to remit through the banking channels. Huala Undial system, they get 230 rupees, whereas they get only 203 rupees through the banking system, and then the central bank might pay additional 10 rupees, as your friends just said.
Yes, sir.
So 210 or 213 rupees they might get, but whereas Hawala Undial market, they get 230 rupees. So that does not point to a market development as such, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So we'll have to rethink over that paragraph.
Yes.
Because wherever is a fundamental reason, isn't it? Wherever there are restrictions by law or the regulator, people would like to break it.
Yes,
no government can challenge the markets. It's well proven and established. Market forces are very powerful than government interventions. Right? Within a country like Sri Lanka, government and central bank could intervene and hold it for a temporary period. But is the core problem going to be addressed? Now, you yourself are saying that in your remittances, work remittances are reduced. When work remittances through normal banking channels, recognized banking channels, they get only 210 or 213 rupees with the 10 rupee incentive. Whereas they get 230 rupees outside, there's some problem there. Né? So increase in volumes expected by to strengthen the foreign reserves will not come when, as long as there's an anomaly like that. Okay?
Yes, sir.
And what is the expected best contribution by the forex market to the foreign reserve? Expected by the forex market is to give the real value for the efforts of the importer or exporter or service provider in this country, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
When that happens, only they are encouraged. Now, in actual terms, if the demand and supply driven market, if the dollar is 230 rupees, and if the banks are paying only 203 and then the central bank paying 10 rupees additionally, that won't be adequate in the minds of the actual wage earner in foreign countries or the exporters who bring in foreign reserve, foreign exchange for the country. So therefore, the market demand and supply has to be restored in the market in the first place. Central bank has to set their arms free and then do their regulation part and not intervene in the market. And at the same time, the forex market had to contribute by way of new products and new risk mitigating products, derivatives and various other which can other things which can improve the volumes of the forex market. In such a scenario, only the foreign reserves can improve. Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you. Thanks very much for a wonderful effort done by all four of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Then Thilini and Kasapa, are you trying to present it today or you want to do it tomorrow?
We will do it tomorrow, sir.
You will do it tomorrow?
Yes, sir.
How many of you in the team, Kasaba?
Three. Yeah.
So all three we need to do tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So then, any others who did not do a presentation? All did, no? So. Tomorrow at 4 p.m. we'll gather to listen to Thilini and Kasapa and then the team.
Yeah, sure.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much for all those who presented today. And good night to everyone.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.
Good night, sir.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night, sir.
Good night, Tilok.
Sir, sorry, I have a question. These assessments, sir, at some point we will be we will be graded against this, or how does it work, sir?
Yeah, for the assignment, we will be getting marks. That's it.
Okay. So that everything will be calculated at the end of the whole program.
Yes.
Understood. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nilok.